Penguin Random House Audio presents Lucky, How Joe Biden Barely Won the Presidency by Jonathan Allen and Amie Parnes. Read for you by Rob Shapiro. For Stephanie, Asher, and Emma, Ira and Marin, and Amanda. J.A. For Remy, who makes me the absolute luckiest. AP. Author's note. The day before we finished work on this book, President Donald Trump incited his followers to march to the Capitol, storm into the People's House, and commit acts of terrorism against the United States of America. We were enraged and heartbroken over the meaningless violence, the desecration of the Capitol building, where we have spent years reporting on Congress, and the attempt to defile our democracy. As the meeting place of the first branch of American government, the branch closest to the citizenry, the Capitol is both the heart of our republic and the most recognizable symbol of democracy across the globe. Any attack on it is an assault on our liberty, our popular sovereignty, our culture, and our way of life. Sadly, the president found aid and comfort in the voices and votes of a shocking number of Republican lawmakers willing to support his delusional and dangerous attempt to overturn the will of the electorate. He was not robbed. There was no fraud. He tried to deny the American people their sacred right to self-governance by every means available to him. We have no doubt that barrels of ink will be spilled on Trump's failed effort to subvert democracy and cling to power in contravention of the rule of law. Likewise, journalists and historians will have their hands full examining the abnormalities and perversities of Trump's presidency, right through a lame duck period defined by desperation and denial. This book is about the reality of the 2020 election. It is about Joe Biden's victory over Trump. We believe that the health of our republic rests on an informed citizenry having as much accurate information as possible, and this book takes readers behind the scenes of the Biden campaign, the Trump campaign, and the campaigns of several of Biden's Democratic primary rivals. It is the story of a candidate whose life, politics, and message best met the moment, as judged by the collective wisdom of the 155 million plus Americans who cast ballots. Biden's victory was conclusive, but at the same time, it was also very, very close. Closer than Democrats or independent prognosticators expected. While it is valuable to look at the popular vote totals to gauge national sentiment, Biden's 81 million plus votes were a record. Presidential elections are decided by the Electoral College. Candidates and their aides steer campaigns with that in mind, competing almost exclusively in a handful of swing states that effectively determine the winner. That system is unjust in the eyes of many Americans, but it is enshrined in the Constitution and cannot be changed without two-thirds votes in each chamber of Congress and ratification by three-quarters of the states. Not only is the Electoral College here to stay for the foreseeable future, but Biden won without any doubt under its rules. He did that by articulating a rationale for his candidacy that focused on what he was uniquely positioned to deliver for the American people. It was premised not on a complex set of policy initiatives, but on a simple promise: to restore the soul of this nation. In his third bid for the presidency, he bet that voters would turn away from the trend of electing outsider candidates vowing to change the system, and toward an insider who can improve their lives by applying his experience and values to that system. Biden presented himself as a man of character, compassion, and competence, traits he portrayed as absent in Trump, and he stuck to his story through both a brutal Democratic primary that almost knocked him out and a general election that unfolded against the backdrop of a plague and societal upheaval over systemic racial injustice. But all along the way, Biden caught breaks. At the Iowa caucuses, in the pivotal South Carolina primary and from an incumbent president who mishandled the major crisis he faced. Those breaks, which he capitalized on, contributed to his victory. But after all the votes were counted, Biden was hardly alone in finding himself fortunate. During the election and in its aftermath, the nation's institutions and its democratic values were put under extreme duress. The Founding Fathers fashioned a republic that could keep power dispersed, meet the exigencies of any moment, and withstand enormous pressures by bending without breaking. Their glorious architecture held firm to ensure the transfer of power to a duly elected president. Luck, it has been said, is the residue of design. It was for Joe Biden and for the Republic. Jonathan Allen and Amie Parnes, January 2021. Prologue. 2 years after Hillary Clinton's defeat at the hands of Donald Trump, the remnants of her political team gathered in the Spartan conference room of her office high above 45th Street in Midtown Manhattan. What had been a billion-dollar, thousand-person operation had since been downsized to little more than half a dozen longtime aides with experience in fundraising, grassroots organizing, communications, and tending to Clinton's personal needs. But even this group of ride-or-die Hillary loyalists wasn't ready for what the leader of their little pack was about to unload on them. It was December 5th, 2018, and with the Democratic victory in the midterm elections now in the rearview mirror, they expected the discussion that day to focus on how Hillary could help the party's candidates. They assumed she wouldn't make a third bid for the presidency. Her defeat in 2016 had been so devastating, so shocking, and so close. Donald Trump had won the Electoral College by capturing three Rust Belt bastions of the Democratic Blue Wall, Pennsylvania, Michigan, and Wisconsin, by a grand total of 77,736 votes. Her fans believed she'd been robbed of the presidency, and her detractors blamed her for Trump's victory. 2 years later, some of her aides were already fielding recruiting calls from prospective Democratic presidential campaigns, and that created a tension point that Huma Abedin, Hillary's closest advisor, wanted to put out in the open. Hillary was absent from the meeting because she had been called away that morning to attend the funeral service of President George H.W. Bush at Washington National Cathedral, alongside her husband, President Bill Clinton, the other living presidents and first ladies, and just about every other current and former federal official of note in the nation's capital. But there was important business to discuss, and the meeting went on without her. In fact, the most pressing matter might have best been talked about without Hillary in the room. Departing from the scripted agenda at the start, Abedin made a special point of noting that one of their colleagues, Adam Parkomenko, had promoted the presidential ambitions of Michael Avenatti, a lawyer and tormentor of Trump who had rocketed to fame by representing porn star Stormy Daniels and leveling a string of allegations against the president that gave him nearly round-the-clock access to 24-hour cable television for months. It was also well known among the group that Emmy Ruiz, an expert in field organizing who had developed a reputation as a star operative on Hillary's two bids for president, was taking calls from several presidential campaigns interested in acquiring her services for the 2020 campaign. Parkomenko and Ruiz had become trusted advisors to Hillary over more than a decade of service to her. While they had taken on other political projects around her runs for office, they had grown up in her operation and were among a small set of her personal favorites. The fact that they were looking at new ventures for 2020 was a sign of just how far Hillary was from the center of the political game 2 years after her loss. It made sense that they would seek new opportunities given that Hillary had told her advisors in the wee hours after election night 2016 that she would not run again, and had said the same thing publicly, repeatedly. That's why Abedin's next words stunned the room. In her mind, Abedin said, she is running. The 42-year-old Clinton family courtier who had earned her savvy through the public tribulations of her bosses and her ex-husband, former Congressman Anthony Weiner, knew instantly that she'd gone too far. After 2 decades at Hillary's side, she could read a room. And this one was not excited by what she had just said. She began to backtrack immediately. There was still a chance, she said, that Hillary might run. The option had not been entirely foreclosed. The point was that a discussion should be had about whether to delay decisions on.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.